Blackstone presents The Wisdom of Morrie, Living and Aging Creatively and Joyfully by Morrie Schwartz, edited by Rob Schwartz. This book is read by Stephen Weber. Foreword and afterword read by Rob Schwartz.
Foreword. I rediscovered this manuscript in the early 2000s, well after my dad had passed away. It was tucked in a desk drawer in his study in our lovely house in Newtonville, the one with the maple tree in front. After much family discussion and consideration, we decided I should edit and take this writing to publication. My dad believed this project would likely be his last mass contribution to help people. He had no inkling that Tuesdays with Morrie would come into existence. But those familiar with Mitch Albom's beautiful book will recognize the thoughts here. Dad was primarily concerned with improving people's lives. He set out to devise practical tips and techniques to help one age creatively, vibrantly, and joyfully. I had the good fortune to sit with Dad and discuss all these ideas when he was writing the book. More on this in the afterword. It just so happened that in the spring and summer of 1989, I was at home after a long sojourn in Asia. Dad was formulating the project at the time and wrote the book during mid-1988 to mid-1992. We were able to explore in depth what he wanted to say, and this has been invaluable in bringing the project forward now. One of my main focuses in editing was to keep my father's unique voice. The work is a blend of Dad's two communicating styles, academic and philosophical, but at the same time, down-to-earth, unassuming, and lovingly personal. I hope that distinctive amalgam has been preserved. Pop was very prescient in perceiving orientations that would become more accepted decades later. He was interested in creating an environment where one's age doesn't influence how one is viewed by society. One of his primary concerns throughout his life was the psychological state of the individual. In much the same way as the Supreme Court observed in its landmark 1954 Brown v. Board of Education ruling, irreparable psychological harm is done to people who are made to feel excluded or somehow less than those in the dominant society. Dad saw how elderly or aging people had been made to feel less worthy than others, and he hoped this book would be part of a movement to correct that. The psychological aspect, related to Dad's professional and academic training, is the backdrop. He hoped to offer practical techniques to help people maintain an active and vibrant life. Some of the suggestions may feel familiar. The idea of using laughter, for instance, Chapter 4. It's a practice that many have written about more recently. Another concept that pervades these pages is Buddhist mindfulness. The episodic nature of the book makes it both engaging and fun. Dad felt the real-life nature of the personal vignettes and episodes was the core of the book. But this is a very different book from Tuesdays with Morrie, though an overarching humanitarianism and universal love run through both. Mitch's superb book is wonderfully concise and deals with the philosophical, societal, and personal values my father had. This book is more discursive. Dad provides many illustrations and stories to exemplify a point. In a way, the two volumes' differing approaches make them bookends for each other. I think Dad would be very happy about this because it reflects one of his favorite philosophical models, the tension of opposites. It is a great pleasure for me to present Dad's ideas. This is the last great writing project he undertook before he got ill. In these pages, I hear his voice ringing throughout, sometimes as if we were back in his Newtonville study discussing the insights. There is no forced retirement from aging creatively. Rob Schwartz, June 2021, Brookline, Massachusetts.
Introduction. Later life is a special period of development with unique limitations and opportunities, and it may be the most important phase of your life. You can change a lot in later life if you really want to. For some, the process of getting older is a troublesome string of transitions. At times, it amounts to nothing less than a shattering of the things we took for granted. If you are preoccupied with your aging, alarmed by it, ashamed of it, discouraged or frightened by it, or if the change in identity forced on you is intolerable, you might find it difficult to concentrate on aging well. On the other hand, if you take your aging in stride and look at it as a challenging opportunity, you can use your attempts to grapple with the issues of aging as a vehicle for becoming the person you were meant to be. Growing old is quintessentially human. If we're fortunate enough to survive middle age, we all will face certain inevitable experiences, both losses and opportunities. Beyond the particulars of our individual biographies, we each face certain common challenges and choices. Will we face our fear of death, or deny and try to avoid it? Will we still try to fulfill our deepest needs, or give up on them? Will we grow into wisdom, or sink into despair? Will we go gentle into that good night, or will we hold on to life with every fiber kicking at anything that would pull us away? Unlike in modern industrialized countries, where many view the elderly as redundant and obsolete, numerous cultures around the globe recognize the later years as a time of profound meaning, transformation, spirituality, and joy. I believe it is possible and desirable for us to do the same. Lately, we see more and more articles and predictions in books, magazines, and the mass media suggesting a changing view toward the elderly, new ways of engaging with and using people in later life, and new anticipations that later life will be a time for achievement, excitement, and creativity. Abraham Heschel says, "Old age can be regarded not as the age of stagnation, but as the age of opportunities for inner growth." There are many good reasons to believe that our lives could culminate in some of the most meaningful, worthwhile, fulfilling activity we've ever undertaken. Almost daily, we see news stories or hear accounts of extraordinary achievements in later life. What's to stop us from developing new perspectives and seeking out new horizons, opening ourselves up to the unexpected and finding new stimulation and a sharpened appetite for living fully? What's to stop us from enhancing the quality of our lives by achieving greater awareness, emotional depth, and self-respect? Yes, even at our age. We can shed light on the nature of who we are and who we might yet become, and what a more fulfilling existence might look like. We can believe in ourselves, have faith that we can change our lives in significant ways and pursue goals we'd never envisioned. And we can believe, as Carl Jung's theory posits, that the greatest potential for growth and self-realization exists in the second half of life. One of the best things about growing older is that no boss is looking over your shoulder telling you what to do. Most of us have more control over our time now than ever before. And when we face new challenges, we encounter fewer external rewards or penalties, leaving us with only those that we give ourselves. We can, however, experience the inner satisfaction of choosing to create a life that reflects our reasonable and adventurous desires and aspirations, thus freeing ourselves from ageist assumptions that tell us we are finished, useless, and of little value. There is no forced retirement from aging creatively. Now is the time to come to terms with old issues that are still dragging us down, to age well, and to become the best person we can be. I hope this book will help you do so in the best, most meaningful way for you. In these pages, I share with you the insights into aging I've collected over the past several years. My psychological and sociological knowledge accrued over a 40-year career as a professor of sociology.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.